Praise the Lord. Dearly beloved sisters and brothers, once again Father has come greeting you all in the name of Jesus and welcoming you to receive the reflections for the day 135 of our Bible pilgrimage. For our reflection, we have 2 Samuel chapters 2 and 3 and Psalm number 93 and 1 Corinthians chapter 2. After the death of Saul, David again asking the Lord if he should come to Judah, and the Lord is bringing him to Hebron. You see, Hebron has great significance because it's there Abraham for the first time in Canaan, you know, owning a small property as a burial ground to bury his wife Sarah. So in that way, this is the first piece of land Israelites possess in Canaan. It was the time of Abraham himself. Genesis chapter 23 verses 19 and 20 speaks about that. Later, Isaac and Jacob also lived there for some time. Chapter 35 of Genesis verse 27. So here, at Hebron, the tribe of Judah accepted David as their king. Samuel had already anointed David privately, that we had seen. You know, it was in Bethlehem. Now the Lord is bringing it into public, making the people proclaiming that God had planned almost what he had planned almost how many? Maybe 15 years back. But Abner, you know, cousin of Saul and general of his commander of his army, he didn't desire to follow the Lord's new anointed king. But he placed Ish-bosheth, that is the fourth son of Saul. He was alive. Other sons had died. So he is bringing Ish-bosheth on the throne, causing tension between Judah and the rest of the tribes of Israel. So the nation in general, you know, not accepting David. So by this, the Lord trained up his servant for further honor and usefulness. And the tendency of true godliness was shown in his behavior while passing through various difficulties now. So here, David is like a type of Christ himself, whom Israel would not submit to, though anointed of the Father to be the Prince and Savior to them. Hallelujah. What is now again remaining in this chapter, worth mentioning, is about the death of Asahel from verses 18 onwards. We find, you know, and the three sons of Zeruiah. Who is that? Zeruiah is the sister of David. Okay, so they were Joab, Abishai, and Asahel. Now, Asahel was as swift of foot as a wild gazelle. In Good News Bible translation, he could run as fast as a wild deer. But he is meeting with a disastrous death. See, death often comes by ways we least suspect. We are often betrayed by the accomplishments we are proud of. See, the area where you are strong, that particular area can be the cause of our downfall. Not always our weakness, but certain areas where we are proud of our strength, that becomes the cause of our downfall. Here, this man, he is known, you know, his swiftness, which he presumed so much upon, you know, that did him no service, but hastened his end. That is what we find here. For example, verse 23 here, 2 Samuel chapter 2, verse 23. Chapter 2, verse 23, about his death. It is said like this: "But Asahel would not quit. So Abner, with a backward thrust of his spear, struck him through the stomach, so that the spear came out at his back, and he dropped to the ground dead. Everyone who came to the place where he was lying stopped and stood there." See, since he was very swift, very fast running, and he almost reached Abner, and Abner all of a sudden stood and had a backward thrust of his spear. And with that, since the other man was so speedily coming, the spear, the other side of the spear, went inside and it pierced his stomach and he died. So his speed, his swiftness became instrument of his punishment and death. That which was his power, in which he was proud of, that brought the downfall. Hallelujah. From this chapter, one more sentence we can see, that is verse 26. Abner called out to Joab, "Do we have to go on fighting forever? Can't you see that in the end there will be nothing but bitterness? We are your relatives. How long will it be before you order your men to stop chasing us?" Hallelujah. So Abner is appealing to Joab concerning the miserable consequences of war and fights. This is true of every sin. It's gonna be bitterness in the end. So it's a warning for all those who are living in sin and pursuing pleasures of the world. Also having, you know, fights, cold wars, or bitterness, hatred, taking revenge. Don't you know that actually we are brothers? And bitterness will be in the end. Why don't you stop? How long will you delay to stop it? Hallelujah. Now coming to chapter 3 of 2 Samuel, verses 2 onwards. The following 6 sons in order of their birth were born to David at Hebron, starting from Amnon. So these 6 sons who were born to him at Hebron, they were from different wives. So he had many wives. Now the question is, was it not against the will of God? Surely it was against the will of God. But the scripture is not directly accusing or judging David about this, but a tree is to be known by its fruit. Later we will find, see, before that, the word of God very clearly had mentioned about it. Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 17. Chapter 17, verse 17. The king is not to have many wives. The king is not to have many wives, because this would make him turn away from the Lord. So it was written, and now he went for many wives. So what happens? The children born of this, you know, bringing lot of trouble later to David. We will find that. Not only to him, but to all of Israel. Among the names given here, among the 6 names, 6 children, at least 3 will be seen later, especially Amnon and Absalom, and to one more man, that is Adonijah. All the 3 will be bringing a lot of havoc. And David literally had to go through a very, very difficult time, full of tears, because of his children. Actually, this is from this, you know, not following the will of God, basically. We don't find him, you know, asking the Lord before taking even wives and so on. For example, Absalom is bringing a lot of trouble later. This Absalom is a son of Maacah. Bible says, who was the son of King Talmai of Geshur. So, this wife called Maacah, from whom he got son Absalom, he might have taken this lady as this woman as his wife because of political reason. She was this daughter of a king of Geshur. However, troubles are on the way, because instrument of sin becomes instrument of punishment. Hallelujah. Now, in this chapter 3, we have the story of Abner and his tragic death. Throughout Abner's life, he appeared to change his allegiance. He was with Saul, later, you know, with Ishbosheth, whom he only placed as the king. Then, when he was confronted by Ishbosheth, because he had a sexual relationship with a concubine of Saul, then he immediately shifting his allegiance to God, and he is proclaiming what God had declared about David. Then he is leaning to David. Behind all these shifts, one sees his real allegiance to himself. Selfish motives led him. He was selfish to the core. So we see this in his declaring of God's promise that David would be king. With Abner, you know, making this declaration to the person he himself had set up as king in the first place. So he used God's promises when the promise was convenient and benefited him. Otherwise, he conveniently left it. So Abner was amazingly consistent his entire life in one thing: his allegiance to himself. That never changed. So, he is meeting with a very disastrous end. Basically, selfishness will bring disaster. So, it's a call to check up our allegiance. We too may be like Abner, you know, declaring an allegiance that is really a mask for our true allegiance. That's ourselves. Even behind some of our, many of our spiritual activities and services also, there can be some this selfishness hiding. We must ask ourselves why we are allegiant to Christ, to His church, to people in our lives. Are we allegiant out of pure motives, or are we really acting on selfish motives? That's what we need to ask. Abner was admirable. We have seen, you know, in many ways, how he deals during the time of a crisis, how he protected, and how he is seen all the time with the soul. So much of good things we find in him. Yet, he did so not as a servant to society and others, but as a servant to himself. His selfishness only brought ruin to him. But the Lord ultimately used all these negative things, this bloodshed and these disastrous things, whatever we find, the Lord is using all of them to bring out even His plan of entrusting David the kingship of undivided Israel. So God's plans, somehow He is, you know, bringing into fulfillment. And all these negative things also He will use. That is the wisdom of God, which human beings, we cannot understand. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now let us come to Psalm number 93. The heading is "The Lord Reigns," or "God is the King." So it's a short and bold declaration of God's majesty, His might, and His holiness. This psalm describes a theocracy. Theocracy means God is the king. He reigns, he rules. You are my people, I am your God and your king. So that is theocracy. God is ruling, the kingdom of God. So next seven psalms are theocratic psalms, meaning proclaiming the authority of God, proclaiming the kingship of God. That is till Psalm 100, we find all those psalms are theocratic psalms. Hallelujah. So here is a small psalm with only five verses. First verses 1 and 2, that is the majesty of God, majesty. First, the majesty expressed in his clothes. Second, expressed by his throne. Then the second part, the might of God, the power of God. That is the might expressed or revealed in the creation, the power of God. Then the last verse 5, that is the holiness of God. So three things: majesty of God, the might of God, and the holiness of God. So the holiness expressed in his words and in his house, in the temple of God. Praise the Lord. Now let us come to St. Paul's letter to Corinthians, first letter, chapter 2. This chapter reveals the method of Paul's proclamation of the gospel. He demonstrates the folly of boasting in human wisdom, and he reminds them how he had come to them. He had no excellent speech or persuasive words of wisdom, he says. Instead, he just proclaimed Jesus crucified. And there, the power of the Spirit was manifested. Mighty miracles happened. People had seen and believed. So the wisdom that is hidden in the gospel preached is not worldly, but godly. That's what he is insisting. That's directly from God. And he describes the process by which God has revealed this wisdom, you know, through his Spirit. That is the main point, how the Lord is revealing his wisdom. Then by the end, he is making a differentiation between two types of people, natural man and spiritual man. It's a natural man who depends on his own wisdom, human wisdom. And he says such people just cannot receive the things of the Spirit. If you are just depending on your own intellectual capacity and the human wisdom, you cannot receive spiritual things. And there are spiritual people. They are led by Spirit of God. They just don't depend on their own wisdom and intellect. Such people will have the mind of Christ. That's what he says. And he's exhorting actually all of us, every believer should have the mind of Christ. We should be spiritual people, not depending on the worldly wisdom, but the spiritual thing that the Lord is sending us, that is divine wisdom, which will bring miracles. Power will be manifested in our lives. Praise the Lord. May Almighty God bless you all, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.